So all of you online, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
We're all good to go. Maybe we'll give it a minute or so. Can we start? Okay, so what's done now? So last time we were in my last class, we talked about motivation, and I had stopped somewhere short of finishing, but I thought I'll talk about it a little bit. We talked about many of these theories, and so we came somewhere here, and I want to talk about the Pygmalion effect and the self-prophecy defying or self-fulfilling prophecy, which is a theory by itself. It's very interesting. A lot of debate on, you know, really whether it sort of holds true in all situations and so on. So the question is, how many of you have been told while you were growing up that you were stupid and you would fail? So I think many of us have actually gone through that journey. My school principal, who used to go by the name Mercy Jairaja Rao, she was the most merciless lady I've ever seen. She would have a leather strap and would beat people up with it. Anyway, so we never got along very well. For many reasons. I thought she was fake. She thought I was rebellious and, not obedient. So eventually, when we parted ways, she told me that, you know, Nagaraj, I don't expect much from you. You will never hold a position of responsibility in your life. So I said, fair enough. We'll look at it. We'll see how it works out. And eventually, I was in command of a 1,500 crore ship, and I had taken delivery in the Netherlands, and we sailed to Visakhapatnam, and I called her for dinner. I didn't remind her of this conversation, but it gave me a great deal of satisfaction. But I think a lot of us were so the self-fulfilling prophecy is something like that, and it's also called the Pygmalion effect. So I'm sure none of you would have heard the word Pygmalion, have you? The Pygmalion is a novel written, it's a work of fiction written by a guy called George Bernard Shaw. George Bernard Shaw is a fascinating guy. He's an Irishman. He wrote in English, and he is a Nobel Prize winner to boot. So Bernard Shaw wrote this book, The Pygmalion, and he describes a very interesting situation where there are two people. One is an English professor who is very arrogant, and he thinks he's the cat's whiskers as far as English is concerned. And he has a friend. He has a friend who is a retired British army officer who has served in India. So one day they're taking a walk in London, and the professor tells this army officer that, you know, I'm so good that I can just pick up anybody from the roadside, and I will train them for 6 months or a year, and they will be able to speak English like Nobel. That is, even the Queen of England cannot make out that this girl is from the roadside. So the army officer says it's impossible. It's not possible. You can't do it in such a short time. So they take a bet. They make a wager. And they're walking along another day, and they see a flower seller. She speaks terrible English. Many Indians speak better English.
Recording in progress.
Yeah. So they take this, they ask this girl, are you up for this experiment? And we'll pay you for it. So this girl thinks about it and then she says, okay, let's try it. Let me see what happens. And this experiment starts. And sure enough, in about a year's time, she is able to speak such perfect English that even the British nobility cannot make out that she's from the, they think she's from very, very high born, so-called respectable family. There's only one problem. Whenever this girl speaks to the professor, she reverts to that street language. And he's puzzled. Yeah, and he's very puzzled, and he asks her one day, and so he wins the bet actually, but he asks her one day, why do you, when you speak to me, why do you speak in this language, but when you speak with other people, you speak perfect English? And she gives him a very interesting answer. She says, because you treat me like a street woman. And so that's what George Bernard Shaw was trying to say, and it's steeped in psychology. If you keep telling people regularly that they're going to fail and that they're stupid, I can assure you that you will turn that. That's why families are very important. When you keep telling your children that you are stupid and you're going to fail, I can assure you, you do it long enough and they will eventually fail. So the answer is, psychologists say that when you're dealing with subordinates, to set the bar high and help them to achieve those goals, rather than telling them or demotivating them, telling them that they are stupid, they're going to sort of fail. So this is very interesting. There's a movie called My Fair Lady. You can go and watch it. It's a very old movie which came in the 1960s or 50s, I think, or before I was born. But it's a very interesting book. So the Pygmalion is a very interesting theory. How many of you agree with this theory? You think it's true? To tell people long enough that they're going to fail, they will fail. Their mind will be molded and they will be very defeatist and sort of defeated even before. So I remember that, you know, when I was playing cricket since my father used to work in Andhra Pradesh, I grew up there and I played cricket for Andhra Pradesh at the school level. So when we used to come up against top class teams like say Karnataka, the match was lost even before it began. Then everybody would say that you would definitely get beaten. So psychologically, you can actually beat yourself, right? So this is a very fascinating theory. So next slide. Motivation, the next. No, this is gone. This is what we did just now. Application. Thanks. Okay, so we have seen various theories. We have seen Maslow's hierarchy, we've seen Herzberg's two factor theory, we talked about McClellan's theory of needs, we talked about Albert Bandura's self-efficacy theory, we looked at the Pygmalion effect, and so on and so forth. But how do you apply some of these theories, really? And what is the greatest motivator that might exist? Can you speak to people and get them motivated? Or do you have to look at something else at the workplace? And I touch upon it sometimes. So what do you think really motivates people at work?
To achieve the target.
To achieve the target. Goals. Yeah, we looked at rocks for goal setting theory. Yeah. What else? And the job is interesting. So the job characteristic model talks about the job itself. You know, eventually we found that money really does not motivate people enough. It, according to Herzberg, it might satisfy you or dissatisfy you, but it definitely doesn't motivate you. Yeah. and so on. So, so the goal set, the job characteristic theory ties in with many other theories like the goal setting theory and management by objectives and so on and so forth. But it fundamentally talks about the characteristics of a particular job. When you look at a job, so what are some of the most, what are some of the worst jobs do you think that are around? Any jobs that you think are not so great to do? Okay. What else? Why is garbage picking so not so great? No respect, okay?
Enjoying.
It may not be something people might enjoy doing, okay? What else?
The security, no security measures.
No security in garbage. No.
Health issues.
Health issues might come in, okay? What else? What else? So they took a survey some years back and I was curious. They said one of the worst jobs that people have voted for are a butcher's job, chopping meat on a daily basis. Many people do it, but they don't seem to enjoy it. The pay is poor. It's not very kind of nice to be surrounded by blood and gore all the time. And I think you don't see a definite goal or an outcome like somebody mentioned here. They could also be health hazards. So many things come together. What are some jobs that are great? Some jobs that are very satisfying and that are great. A doctor's job. Excellent. Yes. What else? Professor, yeah, teacher's job, yes, except that poor teachers are underpaid and overworked, huh? Which can actually cause problems. But what else? Army, the armed forces, yeah, very satisfying. So you're getting the drift. So some jobs seem to be more interesting than other jobs. What about your own, say, IT coding jobs? Are they interesting? Are they jobs that you would really like to do on a daily basis?
Yes.
But I think there's a problem. I mean, the number of burnouts I see where people seem to retire by about 40, 38, 42, 45. There could be a little bit of an issue. Don't you think so?
Yes, sir.
So the job characteristic model talks about core job dimensions. I wanted to pay attention here because a lot of time is wasted in organizations on, thank God it's Friday, parties, taking people out for random cricket matches and so on and so forth. Yeah, I really don't think it works, but that's my point of view. You can go and talk to your HR. So what are some of the core job dimensions? One is skill variety. Can you bring in So one is, of course, skill variety. How much of skill can you bring into the job? Various kinds of skills. So that's why my job is very, I find it very interesting, fascinating, because you can do several things. You can bring in several skills, including some amount of drama, emotion, yeah, acting, and so on and so forth. If you like your job, that's all. Otherwise, it becomes a little difficult to stand in front of people and deliver a lecture and so on and so forth. When I feel bored, I write. So something creative is really happening. No two classes of mine are alike. So skill variety, can you bring in, and jobs that don't allow you to bring in different kinds of skills have a problem. Yeah, if you're not allowed to bring in a vast array of skills, you will then have a little bit of a problem. And something you can think about your own jobs. Do they allow you to bring in different kinds of skills? task identity. Yeah, task identity is can you identify with your job? That's why army personnel, they're very proud about the job they do. Doctors, they're very proud about the job they do. And so many jobs like that. So they have a massive, people who work in NGOs and who make a massive impact on other people sort of have great deal of job satisfaction. So task identity, task significance. So for example, if you were offered a job to be a doctor in a large hospital or to be the chief of security, what would you choose? Chief security. Why? So obviously you're in the main business of the hospital. So you would like to be in the doctor's job rather than being in the security guys. So I don't know why people go and join an IT company and say that I'm managing the buses. Okay, they can't do anything else, that's fine. Or somebody would come to university and say, I want to be the head clerk and collect everybody's certificates. If you're in a university, you should be teaching or you should be publishing or writing. So the task significance is very, very first important. So the three main things that they're talking about, experienced meaningfulness of the work, is skill variety, task identity, and task significance. And then you have two very important things that are autonomy. That is how much of freedom you have in carrying out your job. So the less freedom you have, the more painful the job becomes. The more autonomy is freedom to do your job in the way you think you should be doing the job, rather than, so how many of you go in the morning, line up in front of your boss and say, please tell me what to do today? I'm sure there are many people, yeah, because it's very comforting that somebody else tells you what to do. You've grown up like that. Your father or mother told you for about 25 years what to do, whom to marry, which job to take, which college to join, which course to do. And then now you morph from them to your boss. Till one day the boss is not there, you don't know what to do next. So autonomy is very important. The freedom to make your own choices, yeah, is very important. And eventually, an experience responsibility for outcomes of the work. So you are responsible for the outcomes of the particular job that you are doing. How many of you are responsible? How many of you are think you are responsible if you fail this program?
Yeah.
You sure?
Yes.
Okay.
So the way the information in the brief, that also matters. This the wrong topics.
So that you should raise, you should red flag it and say that you are teaching something that is not right. But if you fail, who is responsible? As long as you can internalize that and be very clear about it, I think life becomes much simpler. Because you know, when I was growing up, and I was probably in my late 20s. When I went for my master's exam, I would always see, and I was a very curious guy. I used to sit outside and see people coming and going. Some would last 3 minutes, some 30 seconds, some viva would go on for about an hour, hour and a half. Mine went on for several days. So the thing is that if the guy came out and he has passed, the examiner will tell you, you passed or failed. If you passed, comes out and says, I passed. If you failed, what does he say? That fellow failed. yeah, it's called, you know, you sort of, your failures are thrown upon other people. Probably it's the way we keep our mental sanity in place, but then it's not a great way to live life or take accountability of what we are doing and where we are. So autonomy, and then the most important thing, of course, feedback. Do you give feedback to people who report to you? Do you receive free feedback of both kinds? positive as well as negative. Only problem with humans is as soon as they hear negative feedback, they go into a bit of a shell. So next time you get negative feedback, please keep your ears open and listen carefully to what somebody is telling you. Could make some sense actually. Could allow you to improve and do something better. Not all bad feedback is good, mind you. There are people, there are jokers who are giving you feedback that doesn't make any sense at all. But then sometimes feedback of the negative as well as the positive kind is good. It allows you to sort of improve. So the job characteristic model, as far as I'm concerned, is the most important model as far as motivation theory is concerned. And you have to remember the core job dimensions, that is skill variety, task identity, task significance, autonomy, and feedback. And if you don't have any of these, particularly if you don't have freedom, and the most boring jobs are those that do not have autonomy or freedom of how you want to do your job. And that's why they say, you must have heard this term called micromanagement. They said, don't micromanage because you're taking away the autonomy and not the feedback. The feedback is you get feedback. You're supposed to get feedback from your bosses, particularly high achievers, people who want to achieve. If you don't give them feedback regularly, they will run away. So feedback is very important in terms of retaining people. Okay, so the core dimensions of job characteristic model can be combined into a single predictive index called the motivating potential score, or MPS. Doesn't make too much sense, don't bother about it. But these five dimensions are very, very important. And they say that probably the two most important ones are autonomy as well as feedback. So how do you kind of keep people engaged and motivated? And several organizations do it. For example, job rotation. You have heard of job rotation?
Yes.
So for example, in Infosys, you had this guy, Mohandas Pai, who was a finance guy who went and became head of HR. Yeah. And or you can have, an engineer becoming an HR guy or a finance guy and so on and so forth. So you can have something called as job rotation. And why is job rotation so important or so good? Why do companies practice job rotation? You get more skills. Yeah, you get more skills and you're allowed to practice those skills in a different area. Yeah.
And it's a win-win situation also for the organization as well as for employee.
How so?
Because if the person is multi-talented, multi-skilled, that person also can, in someone else's absence, can also take that lead. So
you have flexibility.
Yes.
You're building flexibility and agility into your organization because several people can do several things. And good. What are the drawbacks of the job rotation?
The comfort of the
beginning.
Expertise may not be the thing. Comfort zone. You want to, so yeah, true. Comfort zone. So when I joined Dayan Sagar University, and like all universities, you have people who are mischievous and so on. They asked me, can you teach undergrad? So I was already a professor, I was teaching the only MBAs and senior MBA. And I thought it was funny. They said, because undergrads are not very easy to teach. And they can be highly distracted and they can ask you difficult questions and sort of they're rebellious, they're just growing up. They said, okay, let me do it, no problem. I'm not taught undergrad for several years, more than a decade, but I did it. I taught a couple of courses, they all became good friends, nice fellows. They have to be convinced that what you're saying makes sense actually. Once you cross that bump, you're all right with them. But you should get out of your comfort zone, in fact.
Yeah.
And you should keep doing new things. There's another big problem. So would you like to say the flight steward or the air hostess to fly a plane that you're in?
same question.
No.
Why? Job rotation. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So what do you think? I'm asking you a question. Have you ever flown a plane?
Yes.
You're not flown a plane. Anybody else flown a plane? None of you have flown a plane.
Simulator.
Have you flown in a plane?
Yes.
You have flown in a plane? No. Yes, no. No. Please go and fly one. Yeah, you can go fly one from here to Hubli and Dharwad. Yeah? It's an experience by itself. So, what do you think if you replace the pilot with the flight steward? Yeah, which is not a great outcome. Yeah. So the problem with job rotation is that it doesn't work in high risk areas. You can't rotate people. So that is where the Air Force is having a problem, because of politicians and women activists. We actually can tell us a little bit more. So say that women should fly fighter jets. There is a problem, yeah? Because for a country, if the jet is shot across a border somewhere and the woman is captured, the treatment that they receive is not going to be very kind, yeah? So how do you resolve these issues? And this is an ongoing battle. I can see, when I read, the chief of the Indian Air Force says that, you know, it's going to take more time. Modi ji on the Red Fort says that no, all women are equal. We should put them into a fighter jet and send them into a raid across the border into Pakistan. And there is some amount of, but anyway, that is for the politicians and the feminists and the armed forces and to work it out. But the point I was trying to make, without being controversial, is there are some jobs that you can't rotate people into. Yeah? Particularly in high-risk areas like planes, ships, oil rigs, nuclear reactors, high-safety areas, refineries, and so on and so forth. You need specialized knowledge, right? So the weakness, it creates disruptions, requires extra time for supervisors, addressing questions, and training time, and reduced efficiency. So maybe it can be done in a hotel. It can be very easily. You can rotate somebody who's in the front office to, say, taking care of housekeeping. Mistakes are not great. So, for example, there's a lady who joined us. She's an M.Tech in computer science. She joined us as a coordinator. She said, I don't want to go to the IT industry. And she's not good enough to be a professor. So she joined as a kind of a low-level coordinator. So I told her that, why don't you go to a class sometimes and take some lecture and then see if it sort of works for you. And then we can work on making you an assistant professor and seeing how it goes. It's okay. If she fails, nothing much. All the students will line up and say she's a lousy teacher. And we move on in life. But otherwise, job rotation can be a little bit of a hassle. And then you have something called like job enrichment. Job enrichment is very interesting. And job enrichment talks about, can we sort of enrich a job? So in a hotel, say, there is somebody in the housekeeping section who's getting bored. They're very, very smart. But the person is getting bored. Can we take this person out and place them in the reception? Give them a smart uniform and place them in the reception so that they can bring in a few more skills to the table and they feel excited about something. Yeah. So you think it's a good idea? They can be trained. I mean, it's not rocket science. Yeah. So job enrichment is about lifting the profile. The important thing about job enrichment is, you're enriching the job by giving them tougher jobs, but not increasing their salary.
they don't get any extra money. It is about, so only people who want to volunteer. Yeah. So I have, so for example, when I was looking for an assistant dean in the undergrad programs, I offered it to several people. And only a couple of them said, yeah, we would like to do this job because it's a tough job. And the other guy said, no, we would like to stay here, but get more money. We would like to remain here with you and get more money, but we would not like to go and do a new job. So the guy is doing the new job now. The assistant dean is doing a fabulous job. And I can see that he's got a career that is going to take off really. While guys who said that I will stay here as a professor and do not want to do anything more are not really going to make too much of headway career-wise. So job enrichment, if somebody offers you more work, what will you do? Well, most of you say you are trying to exploit me and where is the money? And I find this fascinating, particularly because I deal with a lot of IT guys. My son also works in IT companies, so I know some are. They want to monetize every minute. You know, if you pay me, I will do this. That is like a pony. You know, what is the difference between you and a guy who carries a head load? You know, if I take it from here to there, you pay me 50 rupees. From there to somewhere else, you pay me another 50 rupees. Yeah? But is life that much only? Is there something more to it? Can you do new jobs and learn while you're doing it? Does a career stop at 40? That's very, what do you think, my friend? He works in IT, I know.
Yes, sir.
What do you think of what I'm saying?
There are times it's going to be fluctuating. It's not a corporate way of
Mama.
Requesting something that you want to get paid or else over. So that is not the right thing. It does not.
Hesru Nakshatra Gotrana or message Madhakandra.
Yeah. So
but then you're weighted. You lose weight.
So job enrichment is a fascinating way of giving people more skills, more identity, more challenge, right? Some people like to be challenged in their job, achieve new things, and so on and so forth. And then relation job design is to make jobs more motivating, that is, connect employees with the beneficiaries of their work. How do you do that? Connect employees with the beneficiaries of the work. So for example, suppose you are writing code for a company and then eventually that code is being used in the bank. Does the code writer get to go and meet to the bank's president or vice president? Does that happen?
Normally.
No. Yeah. So the only company that I have seen from many years that seems to do it is Rolls-Royce. So the people who build customized Rolls-Royce finally get to go and meet the end customer. And they have a drink or break a bottle of champagne, whatever. And they sort of get to know the end customer. Or if you go and buy, say, I got a very expensive small clothes thing from somebody made it in Vietnam. And then it came to India, it looked nice, I bought it after paying quite a good decent sum of money. It sits in my room. Now, the guy who made it in Vietnam does not know who uses it in India or wherever it is. So I think it would be very interesting if in the good old days where the king used to call the jeweler and who made the ring and say he would be introduced. This is the guy who made the ring for you. And I think it sort of motivates a great deal more. So that is relational job design. Okay, so also you can have flexi time. Many of you understand today. So when this whole thing started, flexi time was not very well known, right? I mean, it's pretty well known in the IT industry, but other industries, not too much. So can I come to work, say, at 6 o'clock in the morning and go home at about 2 o'clock in the afternoon. Is that possible? Why not? What's the problem? If you're going to stay at home the whole day and work, what's the problem in coming at 6 o'clock and going at 2 in the afternoon? It depends on the industry time, of course. And the role as well. But generally, companies say that I tried to introduce it in my last university. It failed because people did not want it to succeed. But I said you can come at 7 o'clock in the morning and you can leave at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. Some people can come at 9 and leave at 5. Some people can come at 11 and leave at 7. Yeah. I thought it was a pretty interesting concept and experiment worth doing. That it failed doesn't bother me too much because I knew probably it will not succeed. But flexi times are fascinating ways of giving people flexibility and allowing them to sort of do whatever they do in their other times. So today, how many of you think that moonlighting, do you know what's moonlighting?
Yes.
Yes. What's moonlighting?
Like the employee is employed in one company.
I'm working into government.
Huh. So, do you think it's going to gather steam and it's going to become a way of life in the future? Moonlighting?
So, it might be. But companies are banned.
My Infosys is allowing it. Some IT companies are allowing it now.
Many of the companies are allowing it.
Yeah. Rather than losing employees, I think they're saying you can move as long as you get the job. Done.
And not both the jobs don't coincide.
They don't conflict. There's no conflict. Yeah. So, but what is your thought? Do you think it's going to work as we go ahead into, say, the next 50 years? Moonlight.
Might work.
Yeah. It might work. I think it will. I think security that companies offer are going to become less and less. So, for example, you can get fired tomorrow for no right reason at all. They can just tell you don't come to work. But then they allow you to also moonlight, work in several different companies so that you have something to do. Yeah? Think about it. Because I think generations that are going to get affected is you guys. The concept of job security is the concept of job security is something that is gone. So it might really work. Why? What is the meaning of the term moonlighting working in two companies? Where does the word come from, moonlighting? That is curiosity. Now get that piece of machinery working, otherwise it's a bit rust. Where does it come from? So all of you have been parroting it, moonlighting, where does it come from? What does it mean? What is moonlighting?
I came across the term for the first time today, but I'm guessing that maybe during daytime there's another storm. So
very good. Absolutely. But from where? You're right. From where? So this takes us back to the 1930s when the United States brought in. So do you know the word prohibition? What is prohibition? So first state in India which brought in prohibition was what? Which state had prohibition first in India? Who said Kerala? They drink the most alcohol. Gujarat. So now, right now, so strangely they said Mahatma Gandhi was born here, so we must have. Then our friends in Tamil Nadu followed it for some time. What's the problem with, so do you think this India was the pioneer in prohibition? So this experiment has been attempted before by the United States. In the 1920s, they brought in prohibition and which caused a lot of problems, including moonlighting. So people used to actually manufacture illicit liquor in the night, right? And it was a parallel industry. It was so bad that they produced so much of liquor and they used to sell it on the black market. So eventually, after about 10 years, prohibition was lifted, everybody went back to drinking regular liquor, and everything was fine. The word moonlighting came from there because they used to manufacture liquor as a parallel job in the night. So you have got another word called bootlegging. Bootlegging is because they used to manufacture it and keep it in boots. You know, those big boots to sort of. So the point I'm trying to make is, when you come across a new word, please try to find out what it means, rather than just sort of absorbing. Yeah. Amit Singh, you have anything to say?
No, sir.
Then can you kindly mute yourself, please? Okay. So, so job sharing is two or more people split a 40-hour. So this is very exciting. You and your friend can say that we're going to work only 5 days here. I will come for 2.5 days. He will come for 2.5 days. And don't trouble us too much. You can pay the salary of one person. Where does this work? Where does this, is this implemented anywhere? Where do you think this happens? Yeah, not really job sharing, but real job sharing where one job is split in between people.
Second, shifting,
shift wise. People make a lot of money.
Not shifts.
I'm talking about job sharing, where the same job is done by two or more people. One is a sleeping partner, one is a awake partner. Where else could you have? Job sharing, huh? So job sharing is very, very common in, say, oil rigs. Yeah, people go and say one set of crew goes and works for 2 months. They all go home after that. Another set of crew comes in 45 days. Yeah, or 1 month. You can go in or some ships. Yeah, high stress jobs where they come and work for 1 month and go on 1 month of leave. And then they come back after 1 month. This set goes, another set will come. And airline pilots, many ship captains all follow job sharing, where two or more people share a single job. And it seems to work well. They get a lot of time for themselves. They get, they're also not so stressed. And the company doesn't lose by paying, you know, multiple people. So the disadvantages are that you can have actually people moving in or out. You need a lot of professionals. So I've seen on ships where people, you know, two captains can hate each other, but they do a very thorough handover and takeover. But if there is a problem there, you know, it's a handover takeover.
Yes.
You hand over an asset, right? So you say a new captain comes, the old captain hands over the ship to him. So it talks about the crew's problems, machinery issues, safety factors, what work is being done, and so on and so forth. That has to be done thoroughly well. Otherwise, there is going to be a lot of confusion. Yeah. So, job sharing is another interesting aspect of job motivation. Telecommuting, you all know what it is. People work from home. I don't know how well it works, but I don't know. Some people feel that it works. It doesn't work for me. I like to come to the office. Yeah. So working from home is called telecommuting, and many organizations seem to be following it. How does it work for you guys in the IT industry and other industries? Working from home, does it really make a difference? Helps? So why can't you live in Whitefield? It's not part of Bangalore, I understand. Yeah, but why should you stay in Banshankari and work in Whitefield? That is the question that bothers me.
The person who lives in
Hello. Hello. They are putting some people in the waiting room. Who's allowing them in?
Nobody.
Either than you, Madhaswami, or the Darwin.
But nobody is supposed to force them.
Yeah.
Only you.
No, I can't. I mean,
how are you and this system?
How are they getting back?
Waiting room is enabled.
No. Next time I'll
put the water pen, sir. When they can log out, then if they join it again, no, they'll come directly.
Of course.
So we have to enable you.
Enable you.
Yes.
Okay. Thanks. I put people in the waiting room, don't allow them. Okay, so telecommuting advantages are positively related to objective performance and job satisfaction, reduces work-family conflict apparently. Yeah, because people can spend more time with their families and reduce carbon. What are we talking about?
Whitefield.
Apparently, one of the big stressors is the travel to work. Many people leave their job because of and so my son has these romantic notions. He's been in the US now for 7 years, and he said, "I'm relocating back to India." So he came, and we live, of course, on the Banapura Road, South Bangalore. And he had to go to C.V. Raman to his Google office. So he started with 4 days in a week. He said, "I'm going to go 4 days." Then it dropped to 2 days. Now he's saying, "I'll work from home." Now he said, relocating to India may not be a great idea. So travel to work is tough. Yeah. So you might like to think of working in But any companies are giving you permanent work from home? Yeah. How does that work? You don't have social contact, you don't meet other people. Is that a good thing?
I partially agree because at times if the team is global, it's a global team. Like my own team is globally located. I'm the only person from India. So there are people from China and Romania and Mexico and the US, UK and all. So it's just work from home works for every now. The whole team works from home.
Yeah. Works for your good.
And then weekends together.
Weekends together. Have a drink. Together weekends? No weekends also. That's the problem. So, one of my colleagues said, was saying that his son works with some company which is permanently work from home. Every 2 months, they take them to some resort. And for 2 days, and they have whatever they do. And then they come back. And then again, go back to working from. It's very interesting how these things are going to pan out. And doesn't work for me because I'm a guy who likes to talk to people and be around people. And like that on ships, it's been like that here as well. Yeah. So importantly, it reduces carbon emission. Now, particularly in a place like Bengaluru, where everybody likes to take out their big car and travel alone, Lanshankri to Whitefields. Huh?
Yes.
To drive. In what? Alone. Or your carpool. That's what they're talking about. Yeah? Carbon emission.
Many companies, introduce the carpooling in their, like Infosys. One person is traveling, some who stays nearby that place, again, can go in the same. So they have introduced, but may not be successful. Because of the security or whatever.
Because
of? No, it's a safety. Safety.
Now, how does safety come?
If I'm the only person who drives the car, I make stops around the car. If someone is inside my car, they can have to take off my personal stuff so they can.
You think that
they're running your first time? No, not like that. Not every time. Some people are road chain stops.
Even some companies, they have a rule. So you cannot drive alone.
Yes.
They don't allow one person to drive
alone. And that kills enough of people. They have this rule. US has Netherlands had a special rate for petrol. You get a different color petrol if you are carpooling, which is much cheaper. US has a special lane. You can use a special lane and you travel much faster. US is good. You can go on an app and then say I'm traveling from here to there, and random people will come. They pay, say traveling from one city to another city, you can pay $20 as that. Get a lift. Right, I'm still puzzled about your safety angle. I think somebody's going to attack you or something.
Not exactly. So, like, some people, they don't share the stops. They don't like it.
Don't go with them. I'm sure there are other people who want to share their stuff and do car.
Esteem will come here. Esteem. Some people will feel esteem and they don't want,
Anyway, each to themselves, but definitely people take like him, people taking a car and going from Panchankri to Whitefield. I did that, 2007, I was director of a IT company, and I traveled from Panchankri, where I used to live, was next to Whitefield. It was a disaster. This is from 2007. I gave up my job very quickly. Much worse now.
Much worse.
We do change the number. I'm also changing the number.
Yeah, but please remember that it might actually cost you your job. because the stresses on traveling large distances to get to a job, actually enough of research is there to show that it doesn't work. Okay, so employer disadvantages are, of course, social loafing. Social loafing, I've not talked about. So what is social loafing? You're not interacting, that is one part. Social loafing is? So we'll talk about it when we come to groups. But there was a guy called John Ringelmann. Ringelmann did a very interesting experiment. He got several people on either side of a tug of war. All of you have done a tug of war?
Yes.
You know what's a tug of war, right? Cool. So Ringelmann actually got people to pull, and he hung a force measuring scale, dynamometer. So he said, two of you pull, and let's see what is the force applied. So he found that both of them, you know, used, say, they pulled at X newtons force. And then he introduced a second guy on either side, and it became 2X. He brought the third guy, it became 3X. Fourth guy, 4X. Fifth guy, 5X. Sixth guy, 6X. So when he brought the seventh fellow, he expected it to be 7X. It wasn't. It was 6.7X. When he brought the eighth guy, he thought it would be 8X, but it was not 8X. It was, say, 7.2X. And he found that as he introduced more and more people to pull, the output was less and less. It started dropping steeply till a particular point of time when there was absolute chaos. So Ringelmann showed, actually, it was a classic experiment in the US. He showed that the more people you introduce who are not monitored carefully, they will stop contributing. Yeah, and it's called, the classic term for that is social loafing. You also have social loafers in your groups. I've deliberately made groups like that because I wanted you to understand that you will have social loafers. People who will be part of a group but who will not contribute because they figured out that the rest of the members will do the job and they will get away with it. Till they go somewhere and get stuck. They get a tough boss like me, and who understands this game very well, and they will get stuck and sort of either leave or. And you've got social loafers everywhere, particularly in loosely governed organizations. These guys do not contribute, and they just hang around. And so the larger the team size, so Don Ringelmann said that any team that has more than 6 people will have social. So the optimal size of any team is 6. Anything more than 6 starts creating problems because you're going to have social loafers. What do you think of this theory? Do you think it's an interesting theory?
Yes.
Does it make sense?
Yes.
Yeah. So don't have large team size. So it doesn't work really because people won't contribute. They figure out very intelligently that somebody else is doing the job. So why should I? I will do the minimum required to survive. Then you've got, of course, employee involvement. Are employees really involved? Participative management. What is participative management? Can you get everybody through? Do the bosses only take the decision, or they get your point of view? So, I was having a conversation with my son just before he came to the US, and he was saying that Sundar Pichai was telling Google employees that non-essential travel will be is going to stop for some time. Yeah? And somebody from the audience asked him that you are sitting in New York and not in Mountain View. So was your visit to New York essential or not? So actually he gave a very patient answer and said that it was required because he had gone to New York to do some business deal and not on a company paid personal trip. So participation of employees, even asking tough questions to the CEO is very, does it happen in Infosys? Can you ask Narayan Murthy tough questions? right? I mean, he's like the godlike status. But in several companies, you can actually ask, participate, be involved, and do it carefully. Do it carefully, otherwise you might find yourself without a job. I had a student, very smart girl, very talkative, and also pretty to boot. She got a job with a company in Electronic City, and she joined them. And apparently the boss, the owner, founder, he was away in the US, he came back, and she took an appointment. And he said, who are you? She said, I just joined 2 days back, and told him, this is wrong with your company, and you should do this to make it better. And so he called the HR and said to her, full and final settlement. And then a lot of rona gonna happen now. Right? So obviously you must also know organizational relations. Which organizations accept this kind of involvement and outspokenness, and which organizational intelligence is another good word for all of you. What makes an organization tick or run? Is it pure intelligence? Say if you're a very intelligent person and you've got great qualifications, does it guarantee you will become CEO? What guarantees it? How do some people really rise to the top and others fall by the wayside?
You need from others.
Yeah. What else?
Skills.
So most people don't understand how the organization works. Who are the shakers and movers? I remember in my last university, there was a guy who joined. He used to always wear a nice coat and tie and so on. The first thing he went and did was fight with a transport fellow. And the transport fellow, unfortunately, was an old timer and very close to the founder's family. So they made sure he never got a vehicle, and his job was to go to different companies and make business. And that they made sure he never got a vehicle. And so he resigned in about 3 months because of inefficiency. Nothing to do with the fact that this guy was denying him the vehicle. But he had no business to show. And the founders didn't care much that he was not given a vehicle. So organization intelligence is a very important thing. You need to understand who moves what in an organization. Yeah. And if you say, I'm going to rely on my skills only, then go and join companies like Microsoft, Google, and so on and so forth, where they nailed all those things. Just because you're close to, say, Larry Page and Sergey Brin, you're not going to get a promotion. Yeah? They managed all those things well. So go and join. But otherwise, you should be very, very cognizant of what happens in an organization. And at least don't go and quarrel with people who are close to the top manager and who can actually make life a little, they can just strangle you, prevent you from function. Yeah. Okay, good. Participative management, joint. So how do you get participative management? Say new age organizations. So this actually started, this tamasha started with public sectors. So where they would have two workers on the board, we believe it, two bottommost workers will be put on the board of the company, and they were to come eat the cashew nuts, biscuits, go to the five-star hotel, join the meeting, say nothing. But they have a seat at the table. I don't know how well it worked or did not work. Yeah, but several public sectors had this participative. You also got quality circles where people come together, you know, and talk about quality and how do we improve an organization and so on and so forth. It allows people to feel that they're part of the decision-making process when you involve them in the, what do you feel? Is it a good thing or no? But I've seen generally it doesn't work because people who, with all of you, they just keep quiet and listen quiet.
But what is the logic of the bottom level people?
So the good question. So the thesis here is that top level people don't know what is happening at the ground level. So if you bring ground level people And the top level people will understand actually what is happening at the ground level, which actually doesn't happen.
Right, but actually it doesn't, but with the people who come from the ground level, it doesn't speak much.
They don't speak at all. So how do you sort of get an input? Maybe it's better to have a good feedback mechanism.
The feedback mechanism with a manager, when you've been executives in the ground, you have managers in the
supervisor. But it's a problem that has not been solved as yet. How do you get the bottom? When my father was working, I could see that there was always this tension between management and worker. The management is exploiting the worker, and we have to do something about it. The management felt that the worker was not working. So, very interestingly, I used to always be in the thick of things because my dad used to come home and discuss what happened in the office, which is very interesting. And he was an engineer by profession, but became director of HR for a large company which had about 15,000 people, workers. And those were the days of communism. You don't understand it because communism today is finished almost. Yeah, but those were violent communist people, and they would threaten families. So sometimes maybe our family was threatened. You can't go to school. If you step out of your house, you'll get beaten up, and so on and so forth. So the company he was working, it had a hospital. It had a school, it had a junior college, it had a senior college, it had a Kalyan Mandpa, it had a temple, it had a Gurudwara, it had a mosque. So the question that he would always, and the canteen was brilliant, it would serve vegetarian, non-veg, chicken sandwiches. So the question that he always asked was, are we building ships or are we doing several other things? And he once took this drastic measure in saying that henceforth there will be only vegetarian food served in the tank. There's a big ruckus, I remember. One of the union leaders came and said, how can you do this? How can you remove non-veg from the canteen? So he said, we are here to build ships and not eat food. Eat food at home, come here and they're not very amused by it. But anyway, it was a very interesting lesson for me. Going through that, why do you think, what has happened to, just as an aside, this I'm talking about 1970s stretched into the 80s. What happened to the unions? Where are they? Do you hear of unions?
Yes, still there in the manufacturing.
But they're not as violent as they used to be. There's a fellow called Dr. Datta Samant in Maharashtra. He was a terror till somebody put two bullets into his head on near Juhu or somewhere. Nobody knows who did it. But then he would terrorize the industrials. What happened to union? So in Karnataka, which company has the most trouble? Two companies in Bengaluru.
Toyota,
absolutely right. Another one is that Maiko, Bosch.
Bosch,
right? Who wins there? So Toyota is a very interesting story. Toyota, when the workers went on strike, they had a union and they went on strike, the Toyota management, and they went on strike. What's called as a wildcat strike, which is illegal. They're saying, from this moment onward, we won't work. So normally managements will call you for a negotiation and said, please don't do it. So Toyota responded very interestingly. Toyota closed the gate, it's called a lockout, and said, we are closing the factory. All of you stay. And don't come in. And then the union and the workers did not know what to do. So they went, where did they go? Their godfather sitting in the Vidhan Sabha. Who called people Toyota for a meeting? So the meeting was fixed at 10 o'clock. The industry secretary, the minister, Everybody was there. Toyota didn't show up. Management didn't show up. They said, why didn't you come? No, we don't feel safe. This. So they fixed another day. They didn't turn up again. So now the tension was building. And then the chief minister called the top brass of Toyota and said, negotiate and open. He said, we're closing down this factory and shifting to Mauritius. The government actually realized that you can't muscle these guys anymore. They've become too powerful and too big. And you can't bully large industries anymore. Just think about it. The market capitalization of a company like Google is much bigger than the GDP of Pakistan. One company has more value than the GDP of a
country.
Of a country. Apple is actually closing on the GDP of India.
Yes.
Think about it. These are powerful entities and you can't bully. So once the multinational came into India, the union story was gone, finished, over. Yeah, they'll only bully these small fellows who have some 10 workers, 15 workers, and say we are from the KRV and or how many people are speaking Kannada here and so on. Yeah. But otherwise, much of them are done and dusted, except for where they have large political support and they don't care, like our two friends in Kerala and West Bengal, where nobody wants to go in any case. Yeah. But otherwise, the union story is done and there is no participation. Why don't your IT companies have unions?
No.
Do they come at the constraints of India or no?
No. It was like, I mean, till 2020, the industry was not stable. So that's why they did not allow unions till late.
Good question. No, it's not true. Why does your IT company not have a trade
union?
Suppose when you join, which very work CVS.
TVS.
Suppose when you join TVS workers, they take an undertaking that you cannot leave the borders of Tamil Nadu. And you signed it. Does it hold good? Now, why?
They can monitor.
Let's assume they can monitor. Why doesn't it hold? It is against the Constitution of India, which gives you the freedom of movement. Right? So the right to form trade unions are given to people. Why do your IT company? You have a trade union. They have, right? Whatever the trade union is. But IT, say Infosys doesn't. Why? So that is what I said, curiosity. Think of these questions, reflect upon them.
Well, what I feel is that the job.
So this is quite a technical answer, so I don't want your feelings. So what is the technicality of the point here? Bull.
The business will get.
So the simple reason being that an IT company is a shop. So an IT company, however big you might be, comes under the Shops and Establishments Act, which you shall hear of more in your next Prime Minister. While a company like his is a factory. Yeah, the Trade Union Act of India says that you can have unions in factories and not in shops. So when they amend that act, then you guys can start having unions and muscle the management a little bit. Otherwise, you have to keep quiet and say we're in a shop, we can't do much. Yeah. So folks, please, ask these questions. They're very important questions that you need to ask. Why is it that TVS has a union? Why is it that we don't have? Now, most companies will go and sort of send these union leaders to some holiday in Pattaya or Bangkok or somewhere. And then they will buy peace and everybody is quite happy. But this was not the condition in India about 25 to 30 years back, where it was really tricky. So interestingly, this company where my father worked would build one ship in 14 months. 15 months, And it was bad. Then they had something called as the emergency. Have you heard of the emergency? 1977. Yeah. Indira Gandhi abolished what? What did Indira Gandhi abolish? What is the emergency? The Constitution of India was put in abeyance. That means you could not claim any
rights.
Your right to freedom of speech was
forbidden.
Your right to freedom of movement, your right to trade unions was lost. Would you believe it? From 14 months in building a ship, they came down to 2.5 months. They could start building one in 2.5 months. Why? Because they told people that if you talk too much and not work, you will be put into jail. Yeah? And efficiency shot up across the... But then we had a democracy, and then she lost the elections in 1980. And many other things happened. The emergency, a lot of excesses happened in North India, where peculiar things happened, and so on and so forth. So I suggest that you read up something about management history. That's very interesting. It's very interesting because your parents went through much more difficult times than you fellows are going. It's not like sitting in an air-conditioned cabin or a cubicle and doing some abstract coding for somebody sitting in Venezuela. So shall we take a short break? Any questions you have?
So coming to this point, before 4 days, the federal government implemented the rules and going forward, we realize that no layoffs need to be done. It should be done by the companies. Before like saying any like mass layoff will be happening, they have implemented government and they have to give a valid reason.
They will give work.
But the thing is how effectively companies will follow. We can follow.
So the something that is very interesting in India is that you have got an act called the Indian Contracts Act. Yeah, and in brackets it says abolition. Yeah, which many people miss. What the makers of the Constitution were trying to say is that you will not have contractual labor in India. When did they say this? In the 1940s. You have contractual labor.
Yes.
Yeah? So, notwithstanding the fact that it's part of the Indian Constitution, you still have, because organizations. So, politicians have to play this game. They have to please you, they have to please come, because they all know. Tomorrow, they try to act funny with Toyota Kirloskar, they will really move. Like Ratan Tata moved his Shingur. A company from West Bengal to Gujarat. Mamata Banerjee didn't lose. The local people lost. Yeah? And they will go. So politicians have to make these right marches because they are all now afraid. Because you are afraid. Whether you can get laid off by like Twitter or you can get laid off by some other company. You can get laid off by, say, Amazon. Amazon is saying major layoffs are in the offing. What's the big deal? So people go crying. So India people are not used to this layoff business. So if you don't have anything to do, go and drive an Uber. Why not? What's the problem? Is it a problem? No, right? I mean, but it's a problem for several people. Who would like to drive an Uber? No. You will starve to death. But in other countries, the ethos is very clear. If I am making money, I will have you. If I am making a lot more money, I will give you a lot more. That's why you get your bonuses, you get your, incentives. You get money. At that time, you don't ask this question, why are they paying me? Yeah? But when you are laid off, you make this noise. So the ethos is very clear. If my company is doing well, I'll have a job for you. If my company is not doing well, and no government can pay you. Because organized, so this our friend Shri, former Prime Minister Devegaud, he keeps saying that you must have only local people in IT companies. Has he been able to implement it? Politicians will keep saying many things because they have to get votes. So in short, there is nothing like job security anymore. How do you establish job security? How do you establish job security? And making sure that you have enough of skills that some other company will take you if you are
enough from one.
Why should we get stuck on one company? No, can't send me home. So that's the future. There's a very interesting thing called gain sharing. I'll send you that. It's a very, it came up in the US in 1935. So in manufacturing companies, very nice concept. Before I break, I'll talk to you about it, which you should think about. So gain sharing is, so the budget is drawn, the cost budget is drawn at the start of the year. Say your cost for this particular year is 10 crores. Yeah? And everybody agrees upon it. Then the union guys are involved. And they say that, okay, our cost this year is 10 crores, everybody agrees. This. Suppose you manage to do the same work for 9 crores. Is it possible? Yeah, people work harder and we save money. Maybe we can do it for 9 crores. So what happens to that 1 crore, which is saved? So that 1 crore goes into a sinking fund, where 20% is taken by the company, 80% is put into that sinking fund, and is kept there. So that year on year, the sinking fund keeps on building. So that when you have times of recession, or they can't pay bonuses or incentives, they dip into that sinking fund and on a proportion pay off the workers. It worked brilliantly because people were incentivized now to work harder, save money, put more money into that sinking fund. They thought it's a fair deal, very transparent. Everybody agreed that 70% will go into the sinking fund, 30% will come to me, 80% will go to sinking fund, 20% will come. And it's very transparent and clear. So organizations must come up with strategies like that, and people should be willing to work harder. The party is always going to end sometime. What do you think? It ends, no? Always ends. One day it will end. My last university where I was working, I never looked out even because it was one of the best universities, and we were very well paid. I was doing extremely well. Suddenly, the founders quarreled one day. And there was a lot of quarreling which happened. Senior people like me got drawn into that thing, and we eventually left, or we were forced to leave. There's no time to cry. I mean, you know, you went in, looked out for another. But I still know people, my colleagues, who don't have a job. They're hanging around. So the secret of it is to build necessary skills and competencies that will keep you insulated against layoffs, recessions, and so on and so forth. To think that the government is going to come to your aid is the most foolish part of it that can ever occur to anybody or like all of you. Any other question?
So, what were the major reasons for considering IT companies as startups?
I think the British part is interesting. They made the Shops and Establishment Act. IT companies were marked. Factories are denoted by you must have machinery. That machinery should be powered by either steam, electricity, and so on. These acts were made about 100 years ago, at which time nobody visualized that there would be something like an IT company. So when the IT company turned up, They went and looked around and said, where is the machine? Where is the steam? Where is the power? Where is the hand power? The loom? They couldn't find. So they said, this is a put it in the shops category because they have to put it somewhere. Yeah? So they said, okay, Infosys is a no different from the Kirana Mukam. Exactly the same. So, my friend, there is no rationale to everything in this world. The more educated you become, you will find that many of these are man-made laws. So, all of them need not be rational. Somebody made it to that particular point. How do you change it? You can go and vote. Get a government of your choice, or you can lead a revolution on the road. And you can say, I want these things changed. And then you get lucky charge for a short or bus. Yeah? Or you can sit quietly and say, okay, and move on. But does it bother you that you don't have a meaning? No. So unions, so for example, let me ask you a question. Have you seen universities, you go to any university or college in fact in Bengaluru and you look at them, they will have a board which is rusted and frayed and now you can't read even properly. But if you look carefully, it says, no cigarette shop or liquor shop can be located within some
100 meters.
Where do you think that came from? So, what are the idiots? I mean, people can go 100 meters and then have a drink or smoke, right? Where do things came from? Well, fascinating. So, you should, that's why I read. Where do you think this board came from? Who brought this board? Why? Were these foolish people? What do you think? Yeah, true. They thought about the children. And the children also are smart. They will go and drink or smoke. They will smoke other things also, like grass and weed. So, interestingly, there is an act called the Indian Plantations Act. So if you look at plantations in India across several parts, they found that first of all, the worker on a plantation would get a pittance. Yeah? And this was a thing brought in by the British. Yeah? Just outside the gate, they would have a liquor shop. Yeah, which was also owned by the plantation owner, where they sold arak or whatever. So the worker in the evening would be dead tired, would get some few paisa for his day's labor. He's not thinking straight. He would go outside the gate, see the liquor shop, spend most of his money or all his money on liquor, go home and beat his wife. Yeah, which I assume happens today as well. But the problem here was that one is it made the plantation owner very rich and the general worker very poor. Families were being destroyed. So some sane fellow said that, look, at least let us give him 100 meters to think whether he wants to drink or not. At least that time, let him apply his mind so that he doesn't waste his money on liquor. So they had that thing 100 meters away. That has percolated to schools also and colleges. In an age where it doesn't make any sense anymore, because I don't see anybody walking, they all come on various fancy vehicles. Yeah. So but the point I'm trying to make is that maybe 150 years back, these made eminent sense. Do they make sense today? It's something to think about. And these were smart people. These were well-intentioned people who came up with the Indian Trade Union Act is brilliant. It is really good. It was misused, unfortunately.
Yeah. Sorry, today also that matters, keeping 100 meters away, because this psychological effect, whenever we see immediately in front of our eyes that something is there, so it entices us.
Yeah.
So if it is far away, if it is not visible for us, we may not think.
But do people today also drink and go and meet their wives?
It's quite impassioned.
But then somebody well intentioned thought about this strategy and got it in. So the point I was trying to make to all of you is please read it. So I want to ask you a question. I am tying up with an agency called Maxter, which will give us about 5,000 odd magazines, periodicals, newspapers from across the world, yeah, which will come on your phone. So you can say read the Economic Times or the Hindu Business Line or the New York Times or the Washington Post or the newspaper from Spain, wherever. You get to use the small price, of course. It's very economical. But I want people to read. You're not reading enough, unfortunately. You're listening to what WhatsApp and I'm sending some messages and watching some browsing movies. What was the last one you watched? You just think, actually, you would have watched my
yesterday. Actually, sir, I used to watch podcasts and economic forum type
of. All students we get here are very intellectual.
Actually, I really like a lot of geopolitics.
So, the other day I had this guy who wanted to join us, and he has done his PhD. So I was doing this interview and I asked him, okay, what is your thesis? And he said, I have done something on BRICS. So my colleague, Dr. Shankar, was asking some highly technical questions and everything went on nicely. And I just asked him, you know, BRICS is what? What is the B in BRICS?
Brazil.
He said, Brazil. I said, where is this? He said, I don't know. So I said, really? I mean, when I see people like you, I'm afraid. Because do I put you into a classroom? If you've done a PhD and you don't know where Brazil is, the largest country in South America. So it's frightening. What do you think? You don't get the full purport because most of your professors here are very well-read people. Yeah? But if you go to many colleges, they really have no clue what they're talking about. Good. We'll take a break. Guys online, we'll be back in about 15 minutes.
Okay, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, so we'll move on to something that is really fascinating, that is you guys online, can you hear me?
Yes, Professor.
Okay, so we'll move on to leadership. What is leadership? What is your understanding of leadership? Why are leaders tricky people? Why? See, leaders, everybody wants to be a leader, but what does a leader do mostly? Sindhu, are you there? Sindhu? So why are leaders tricky people? Why are they called leaders? Something to think about. Can you talk about any leaders that you know? Have you heard of any leaders?
Gandhi.
Gandhiji. Mahatma Gandhiji. Was he a leader?
Yes.
Why was he a leader? Why do you qualify him as a leader? Well, that's fine. I'm asking you. Why do you qualify them as a leader?
To see the world in a different way.
Very nice. Took an initiative to see the world in a different way. What else?
Life changes.
Life change. Very good. So leaders are people who have a new vision, like you said, who drive change and who bring about revolution, who want to bring about a new paradigm. Yeah, that is why they are tricky people. So managers are pushing for stability. If you look at any manager, they are always talking about
stability.
They don't want people to bring about rapid change and revolution. It's not what. And that is why many leaders fail, because the important part of leadership is change management. And many people cannot manage change well. So while you might think that you're a great leader, please figure out whether you can manage and control change well. Otherwise, don't get into leadership positions. Yeah, because you will fail. So leadership is, of course, a fascinating area, and which applies to all of you. What kind of leaders you are you? So leadership evolved, and several hundred years back, they said that Sharafuddin, do you have something to say?
I'm sorry by mistake, let's open.
Yeah, this is happening for the third time, my friend. Next time you will go into the waiting room and not come out.
I'm sorry.
So, so leadership has evolved. And if you go back 700 years back, they would say that leaders are born. So, for example, Genghis Khan. Ever heard of Genghis Khan? Genghis Khan was Central Asian tribal. He was a guy in Mongolia.
he rattled the world because he, at that point in time, controlled the largest landmarks. He went both east and west into China. He went west into Europe. And they say that they recognized him as a leader when he was born because when he emerged, he had a blood clot in his fist. And they, for the Mongolians, they say this is a sign of a truly great leader. Similarly with Alexander, who came much before Genghis Khan, or Ashoka, or Chandragupta Maurya, or in Karnataka, you have Pulakeshi.
Manjunath here. Can I ask a question?
Please.
Professor, I was just wondering the name, what you were referring, right? It's more about the ambitions, what they brought in, right? Whether a Genghis Khan, because if tactic in war, or Alexander winning over the world. So how do you actually see, you know, differentiate with their leadership or their born leaders?
Well, what I'm trying to talk about is leadership theory, how it has evolved from several centuries. And several hundreds of years ago, leaders were thought to be born, as against today, where we believe that leaders can be made. That was the point, my friend.
Thank you.
I'm not talking about the personal ambition of, or what kind of leaders Genghis Khan was. And have you heard of Genghis Khan?
Yes, Professor. I, in fact, read his story as well.
Very good. So, do you consider him to be a leader?
Yes, Professor, not in terms of people leader, in terms of war leader. I think his tactics, his strategies.
War leader and people leader.
The way he lead his troops, the way he was expanding his origin, his Mongolian tribes.
Yeah. So if you look at, say, somebody like Sri Narayan, was he a great leader? What is the difference between him and Genghis Khan?
Is it a question for me, Professor?
Question to everybody.
What he is people manager and war leader, a war leader or people leader.
Not necessary. Leadership is leadership. But leadership is in what domain? Genghis Khan at that time didn't have an IT company, so he went for grab land. Narayan Murthy wants to have market share and, you know, more revenues and war chest and cash reserves and so on and so forth. Ambani's want to have a finger in every pie. It exists, right? From, say, Adani, from airports to hotels to news channels. So leadership is leadership. It's about ambition. It's about growth. It's about leading people. And it's about expansion. Your methodology might be different, which we shall come to, which we shall come to later. Yeah.
But he had a vision.
So did Genghis Khan.
No, in terms of the revolution of IT was there at his start point of so that is what he analyzed. So that made him an exceptional.
True. So he could see something other people could not. So it's fascinating when you look at these people. What made Alexander cross several hundreds of miles and arrive at the borders of India? It's a fascinating story of leadership and. Were these absolutely rational and sane people? That you have to decide. But leaders are like, Elon Musk is a leader. He brought about change. Mahatma Gandhi was a leader. So Mahatma Gandhi is severely criticized by his sons because he neglected them. Or they felt it. It's a matter of perception. Yeah. So people thought initially that leadership was a trait. It was from where we were born, how we were born, whose children we were, and so on and so forth, that mattered. Then you went into what is called as the trait theories of leadership is what I'm talking about. And then you had, say, the behavioral theories of leadership. And there was seminal research done in two places. One is Michigan University and the Ohio State University. And they talked about, they said, they just simplified it. They said leaders are of two types, leaving alone their ambition and so on. They said leaders are of two types. One is, are you a people's leader? Are you a people-oriented? For example, you are on a tight project, really tight project, and deadlines are sharp, and you are really struggling. And one of your teammates comes and says, my grandmother is sick. I have to travel to, if it was our friend Madheswami, would say, now Mysore Pude. I have to go to Mysore. What do you do? Do you let him go and say, take off, chum, no problem, he will manage? Or you say, forget it, get the job done. What do you do? So that was the behavioral theory of leadership. They tried to delineate between people-oriented and task-oriented. What kind of leaders are you?
Managing board.
What kind of leader do you think I will be? Actually, no. Actually,
professor, probably situational leader.
Yeah, situational leadership comes later. But let's take with behavioral theories. So that LPC questionnaire that has come to you, please open it quickly. Arvind has sent you an email, but LPC I also sent it to you by WhatsApp. Please open it. You'll have to score, so get a paper and pen quickly. Now I have time here. So look at this. And yeah, so what you need to do here is don't do anything and listen to me. Yeah? First of all, think of somebody that you have worked with but do not want to work with again in your life. This questionnaire is about, not about you, it is about that. First, think of the least preferred cohort. Think of somebody that you do not want to work with again. Now, keeping that person firmly in the centrality of things, answer this questionnaire. Do you think that person was kind? If so, mark him a 10. If not, give him a, I don't want to work with you, but I think you're a kind and lovable person. I don't want to work with you because you are a unhappy and cruel person, then you give 0 or 1 or whatever. You understood how this is to be done? Guys online, it's very important. Yeah? One. So whatever you do, think of, thank you, you spoke. So whatever you do, you sort of keep this person in mind and then answer the questionnaire with that person in mind. Okay, is that clearly understood by everybody?
Yes.
Otherwise, you will get wrong results. This is not about you. So, quickly, you got about 3 minutes flat. Don't have it, huh? Then on WhatsApp also. Isn't it? Better come out 5 minutes back. Just send it to him. Anybody finished? You added all the marks?
Yeah.
Yeah? Over to the...
Yeah.
Anybody else? What is your name? Where are you from? You are an Andre who settled in Jamshed.
No, I was born in that up in Jamshed.
Why did you have an
Andre? No, not the time.
What do you mean by me? Okay, so Ashwini, what's your score?
55.
Very good. Anybody else? My friend?
85.
So
I mean 67.
Yeah, so we got 3. Okay. Anybody else?
44.
So people who have got low scores generally indicates that you are people oriented, that you are task oriented. That is, you push for the job, get the job done first, mate, China. Then let's have a beer. The other types are, let's have a beer first and then we talk about people who have high scores in their 70s and 80s, 90s, and how much was it? Okay. So you can now see whether you are a task-oriented person or a people-oriented person. This has large implications on how you gel with your team and what kind of organization you work for. Because if you look at this grid called the Blake and Mountain Managerial Grid, it's very interesting. And it talks about several things. It talks about concern for people and concern for productions. Yeah. And you have say where the concern for people is very high and the concern for production is low, you have the country club management. You should join organizations like this, where they're very concerned about you, but they are not concerned about the work. So if you get a job there, stay there. It's like a country club. Yeah, but unfortunately, not too many jobs like that exist. What kind of jobs exist is like this. High concern for production and low concern for people. Of course, the best guys work in companies like high concern for people and high concern for, this is firmly in the realms of, say, the Googles and those kind of guys who, or maybe the Tatas, in some cases where concern for people is very, very high, so is concern for work. You have to do both, but you get rewarded very well and looked after extremely well. And of course, impoverished organizations, very sad organizations, are they neither concerned about people nor are they concerned about work. So you can try to fit your organization into some of these slots, 1-9, 9-9, 9-1, and 1-1. So this was firmly based on the behavior of people. So the behavioral traits of leadership. Here, leaders were not born, dependent upon the kind of behavior they brought to the table. So you can see that we are evolving. So how does this affect them? And then we have what is called as the Fiedler's model. Fiedler's model talks about, Fiedler came up with an interesting model. And Fiedler, to cut a long story short, you can read about him. He said that he used the LPC questionnaire. So the questionnaire that you did just did is what Fiedler used in his research. And he said that, in a tight situation, in a difficult situation, say your organization is sinking, what kind of a leader would you want? Would you want a people-oriented guy or a task-oriented
guy? Task-oriented
guy. Yeah, so Fiedler found conclusively by research that when organizations were doing very badly or very well, they brought in task-oriented leaders. And when organizations were middling, going along, they did not want to rock the boat. So a good example is, say, for General Electric. General Electric had this guy called, when General Electric was, you know General Electric, right?
Yes.
It's an iconic world company founded by Thomas Alva Edison. And it was doing badly, they brought in a guy called Jack Welch. Jack Welch was terrible. He was called Neutron Jack. He fired people left, right, and center. Then he took over GE. GE was in all sorts of businesses, right? From making plastics to GE, aviation, to giving loans, to making nuclear reactors, to power projects. So Jack Welch comes, sits in his office and says, give me a list where we are not number one or number two. And so his secretary came and gave him a list. And he said, wherever we are not number one or number two, close them or sell those divisions. And so she said, what happens to the people? What do you think he said? Send them home, fire them. So he was a ruthless guy. But the fact of the matter is, he turned GE around very quickly. And his successor was a guy called Jeffrey Immelt. Immelt was this gentle giant, 6 feet 6 inches, very people person. Yeah, he was not like, so you can see that when GE came out of that mess, they brought in a person who was concerned for. Another good example is, there's a nice book, fascinating book on IBM called Elephants Can Dance. You should buy that book and read it. And it's written by a guy called Louis Gerstner. Gerstner came from Nabisco, which was a biscuit packaging company. He knew nothing about IT. So when IBM was in trouble, the president formally asked Gerstner to take over IBM. And Gerstner writes in his book, that when he walked into the IBM office, he was amazed. IBM was doing badly. But he says, my feet sunk into the carpets. The carpets were so rich in the IBM office. And the walls were covered by paintings by masters. They cost millions of dollars. So the first executive order that Gerstner passed was the following. Sell all the carpets, sell all the paintings. Nobody travels business class. Nobody stays in five-star hotels till we start making. And he was a guy who knew nothing about IT. He was a biscuit maker. He turned IBM around very, very. And he had no time for nonsense. Yeah? Either you perform, add value, or go and find another job. Yeah? So these people are tough as nails. And they really mean business. But if you have these kind of people when a company is doing normally quite well, they tend to cause confusion and they tend to rock the boat.
So one article you had shared that preparing the for the next recession.
Right.
So in that it is very clearly mentioned that when you should directly, you have to be prepared as a leader,
yeah.
You have to be prepared and forecast future.
Right.
So that we can avoid a sudden layoff. so that if we have that, you know, balance sheet, very prepared.
So my theory always is when you're having a good time, prepare for the bad time.
Right.
Yeah, not think that it is one endless party like our friend here was. So it's not life is not one endless party, because the bad times will come. They come to everybody. You lose a job, you don't have money, you suddenly find that there are no funds and so on and so forth. Yeah. So when you are doing well, you should prepare for the
future.
And in tough times, the guys who really make things work are the fellows who are task oriented and not people. Yeah. So companies also generally favor task oriented, and there are many examples. So that was Fiedler's model. So you can see here, the graph is there. You can see that task oriented in unfavorable times, you have a task oriented. Yeah. And then you have, so far we have been talking about leaders as such, leaders who, what have we not talked about? We have talked about traits, we have talked about behavior, we have talked about several things. Pertaining to whom? Whom have we talked about so far?
Leaders.
We have not talked about the follower. Are followers important?
Yes.
So, Hershey and Blanchard came with the situational leadership model, which is fascinating, where they tried to incorporate the quality of the follower. And they said that a good leader changes leadership style depending upon the follower. And they said that, suppose I have novice followers, that is people who are very, very inexperienced, very, very low in intellect and so on and so forth, then I must adopt a telling style. I will follow a micromanagement style. I will tell you exactly what I want, how I want, and when I want, and ask you to go and get it done. Suppose I have a team of experts, like our friend, all very serious guys, all great guys. Do I tell them exactly what I want? No, I said, this is the job, going and get it done. How you do it is your business. I give them autonomy. I give them. So Hershey and Blanchard talked about a situational leadership theory, which brought in the follower for the first time into the gamut of leadership theory. And it is fascinating because it makes eminent sense that you should alter your leadership style depending upon the quality of the
followers.
For example, in the 1970s, when I was born, who was born in 1970s? Okay. There was this great West Indian team, led by Clive Lloyd. And Lloyd, actually, they didn't need a captain because the team was so great. I mean, all the players were brilliant people. Even without a captain, I can assure you, they would have crashed any other. So if you have people like that, don't go and make a mess of things by giving them minute directions. They don't need it. All you can do is call them for a cup of coffee or a beer or something and say, this is a job I want done, you should do. You have any suggestions? Take suggestions and then disperse. But if you have a team of novices, people who have just come from college, don't know what they're doing or why they're doing it, then you should adopt different style of leadership. Okay, I think I'll stop there. But leadership is a fascinating subject. You should read about it more. And look at the PPT. Read about, get hold of the book. How many of you have the book? I hope all of you have the book. Go and buy the book. Yeah? Go to Kalasi Palya, you will get a old copy. On Amazon, you get a new copy. Choice is yours. But go and get a
No, I'm just asking the book. Did you buy it?
I have, sir.
Yes.
So I've also got somebody, Arvind will have an e-com, which you can source. Huh? What?
He's asking which book to buy.
I don't understand. We are talking about any books on the readers or the organizer video book.
I'm asking you first to read the prescribed textbook. Then we will talk about other.
We have e-copy access.
And then we'll read it. Huh?
Yes.
Just having the copy is not good enough.
Okay.
We have to do something. So stop, stop. I don't want people. I want video. Okay, so let me play some. There's some fascinating. So we'll play this. Yeah, that one first. Huh? Optimize this one. Here, optimize. Okay, so let me talk about this. This is in the 1960s. The Americans they won the Second World War. It's the richest country in the world. They are entering into World War. They finished World War II. They were getting into Vietnam. And this is the first set of guys going into Vietnam. And it is their commanding officer who is talking to the So today I got all war. What are you doing? I want video. Call India service. Not that. I love power.
Come back.
I'm running out of time. I have to go home and have lunch and sleep. Leave it, don't let it.
Professor Manjunath here. Meantime, Imtiaz sir comes. Can I ask you a question?
Play that one. That one. Oh, sir, hold on. Manjuna, tell me.
With regard to this situational diagram, quadrant, what you showed, right? Based on the followers, it changes. But I was just thinking, sometimes even the followers are same, but the time or maybe the situation around us or industry also makes handling things differently, right? Even though the followers are same. For example, 2 years back, if some situation with the same group may not be same, I would have handled right now because of the evolving industry or evolving situations.
Yeah, good thought, yes. But it has a marginal effect because the leader has not changed. His behavior is not very easy to change. And also the followers have not changed. Maybe their behavior is difficult to change. So unless some paradigm shift has occurred in their own behaviors, it's very difficult to get in a new approach. Yeah. So situational changes can bring in some changes, but not too much.
Thank you.
Yeah, so this is, like I said, Colonel Moore leading his troops. And he's talking about, so just watch it. And let's see, just so I can play the annotations. CC. Not available. Okay, so we'll hear this out. And
Look around you. In the 7th Cavalry, we got a captain from the Ukraine. Another from Puerto Rico. We've got Japanese, Chinese, blacks, Hispanics, Cherokee Indians, Jews and Gentiles, all Americans. Now here in the States, some men in this unit may experience discrimination because of race or creed. But for you and me now, all that is gone. We're moving into the valley of the shadow of death, where you will watch the back of the man next to you as he will watch yours. And you won't care what color he is or by what name he calls God. They say we're leaving home. We're going to what home was always supposed to be. So let us understand the situation. We are going into battle against a tough and determined enemy. I can't promise you that I will bring you all home alive. But this I swear. Before you and before Almighty God, that when we go into battle, I will be the first to set foot on the field, and I'll be the last to step off. And I will leave no one behind. Dead or alive, we will all come home together. So help me God.
So what leadership traits did you discover there? What do you think?
I will be the first to step into the ground.
The first to step in and the last to step off. Very good. What else?
Living by example, maybe showcasing that he will be the first one to lead them.
He's living by, he's walking the talk. Yeah? Very good. What else?
He's backing his soldiers.
He's backing his soldiers, yes.
Leading from the front.
Leading from the front, yes. What else?
Some motivating them.
What?
Motivating them.
How did he motivate them?
He inspires you.
So
he spoke to everyone to not to differentiate people by their.
Very good. That's what I was looking for. He said no differentiation. Mm-hmm. You're all?
You're all
equal. Yeah? What else? He said something else which is important.
That we will not just come all together, whether it is dead or alive.
True. Said, I'll bring everybody. That's very inspirational. What else? He said something important.
He knew the enemy was very.
He said, we are going against a tough and determined.
Yeah.
It is very important to not be overconfident. Yeah? You can't be overconfident, you know? You have to prepare. So he told his people that I will do all these things, but understand that we are going to go against a tough and determined enemy. So be prepared and be prepared to. Thanks.
So movie name, professor.
This is brilliant. We should watch this movie. It's called We Were Soldiers. It's an old movie, but fascinating. We Were Soldiers. Yeah, play that. So this is a similar one, much later. This is an Irishman, and he's taking his troops into. So just let's try to contrast the two speeches of both the commanding officers. What do they say differently or similar?
We are going into Iraq to liberate and not to conquer. We will not fly our flags in their country. Now, there are some who are alive at this moment who will not be alive shortly. Those of them who do not wish to go on that journey, we will not send them. As for the others, I expect you to rock their world. Wipe them out, if that's what they choose. If you are ferocious in battle, Remember to be magnanimous in victory. Iraq is steeped in history. It is the site of the Garden of Eden, of the Great Flood. It is the birthplace of Abraham. You tread lightly there. You'll have to go a long way to find a more decent, generous, and upright people than the Iraqis. You'll be embarrassed at the hospitality they offer you, even though they have nothing. Do not treat them as refugees in their own country. Now, if there are casualties of war, remember that when they got up this morning and got dressed, they did not plan to die this day. So allow them dignity in death. Bury them with due reverence and properly mark their graves. It remains my foremost intention to bring every single one of you out alive. But there may be those among us who will not see the end of this campaign. And we will put them in their sleeping bags and we will send them back, and there will be no time for sorrow. We will grieve for them later. The enemy should be in no doubt that we are his nemesis and we are bringing about his rightful destruction. But remember, it is a big step to take another human life. It is not to be done lightly. I know of men who have taken life needlessly in other conflicts. I can assure you, they live with the mark of Cain upon them. And I know your mas will be in the queue at the co-op next week, and they won't want you to let them down. Let's bring everybody home safely and leave Iraq a better place for us having been there. Our business now is north. Good luck.
That's it, fellas. Follow.
Well, how are these two different?
What if you could grab...
Differently.
Here, the leader is telling to be aggressive.
There also is an appearance.
But here, these people in jail were not people who were.
This guy was a boss.
Yeah.
He was totally worker.
Yeah. Yeah. As against more.
The first one, he was telling like what he'll do along with the group, but he was like,
I expect
micromanaging, like just saying you have to do this and I'll not be there or I'll be there.
Fascinating, because here he was talking more about the enemy.
Yeah.
He was saying Iraq is a great place, behave yourselves well. So there's a difference about 40 years between the first one and the second one. It's very interesting how leadership probably has evolved, and you can listen to it more carefully at your leisure. I'll send you those clips and you can sort of see what subtle changes have occurred in how we look at leadership. He was also telling his people to behave better, something that Colonel Moore did not tell his. Yeah. So Iraq is a place which has got a lot of history. This, that, and the other. Both of them talked about bringing everybody home alive, which is very important because there will be casualties and so on and so forth. Yeah. So, but I think both of those people talked about the task at hand. They also talked about people and outcomes, of course. Yeah. So, you can see that they have a good picture of what leadership is about. It's not just about one thing, right? Either work or people and so on and so forth. And okay, we'll play the last one. This you would understand, right? So this is very interesting. This is Very interesting. It's based on a submarine, and it is basically about again tasks and people. And the captain wants to launch nuclear missiles because he gets a message. He thinks it's very important. His exo, that is the next in charge, believes that he should not do so. And there is some amount of conflict between two people who have both strong leaders. There's also more complexity behind it. But we'll watch the two strong personalities. Yeah. What do you think happened actually? It's very easy when you lead people who listen to you. Yeah. But sometimes you run into people who will disagree. Then what? What do you think complicated this issue?
Taking second opinion.
And then
that is true. All those are obvious things. What is something that you can add which is not obvious?
Understanding of the matter.
Understanding the one message came out clear. They wanted to launch nuclear missiles. The captain and his exo have to agree. All that is obvious. What do you think? What else happened in that complicated issue?
Leader being stubborn.
Very, very rigid. Yeah, this is, I'm the captain and you must follow. Yeah, rules don't matter. So it caused a certain amount of confusion. What else? Good. What else? So even leaders are accountable for process and form.
SOP
is not followed. Correct. Good word. So, what else do you think complicated this issue?
Understanding between these two.
Very good. Lack of understanding. Why?
He didn't listen to him. When he was.
Why did he listen?
Because he is his authority.
What else will be happened by him?
Absolutely.
So if you watch this, he has a very poor opinion of black-skinned people. Yeah. So in leadership, when you bring in extraneous factors like interpersonal issues, biases, it only complicates the. Rather than just dealing with the merit of what is going on, the captain brought in a lot of other things, which include race. This is a black person. Maybe he's not very competent. It also complicated the issue because the exo, Commander Hunter, is not a regular guy. He just come into that submarine. The old guy is not there. So maybe there's a lack of understanding. So leadership fundamentally is very complex, and it becomes even more complicated if you bring in interpersonal issues, biases, and so on and so forth. And all of us do it. All of us have our own personal interests, insecurities, biases. You will become a great leader if you can shut all of them out. Yeah, and look at only the. So, talking about behavior, situation, follower, traits, theory, everything is fine. But if you allow extraneous factors to creep into the situation, you are going to have problems. And let you mull over that. You should close till I meet you next time. Hey, any questions? Anybody has?
Sir, you can stop it. So what are your views on leader like running just before 2022 and after 2022?
So Army put Putin as he's an army guy, former commando. The problem with them is that he has a father figure who behaved similarly to him. That is Musharraf. Both came from very similar backgrounds. The problem with such people is that they look at a goal. They have firmly a goal in mind. They do not look at strategic theater or strategic perspectives as to what else can happen. So, for example, when Musharraf went to war with India and occupied Kargil, he didn't expect India to use the air force. What turned it around was that he thought he'll go and occupy, which he did. Strategic planning was brilliant. Secrecy was great. He did not figure in their strategic planning, they never thought about the fact that India can bring in their air force. Yeah? And India had just acquired missiles from Israel, which for those days were very sophisticated. They could pinpoint these positions and knock them off, which actually flattened them very quickly. So the fact of the matter is that, are they good leaders? I wouldn't say so, because they don't consider, good leaders are people who take everything into account. They're like chess players. They say, if I do this, what will that guy do? And if he does that, then how do I respond? And then they are about five moves ahead at all times. Yeah, so just to directly answer your question, I don't think Putin really understood what would happen if he went into Ukraine. He miscalculated that the West would not respond. And now he's got bogged down. He doesn't know what to do.
So you can't say that, because in 2018 he captured Crimea. And he knew that the importance of that Crimea is.
So maybe it worked in Crimea, but it need not have worked in, it doesn't work in Ukraine.
But in Ukraine also he can see the future, because right now
he can see. But what he miscalculated was how the West would react, how NATO would react, how the Americans would react.
So all of the NATO members are not against
so
Russia.
So whoever is against Russia is good enough. Maybe Turkey is not against Russia, but the United States, England, France are good enough.
Actually, Turkey is one of the Republican countries.
We'll talk about it. But your question was, is Putin a great leader? I would say no, because he miscalculated back. Same thing happened to people like Adolf Hitler when they invaded Poland or Czechoslovakia. They miscalculated. They did not understand what the response would be from the other side. Similarly, Musharraf thought that India would just give up quietly and would lose Jammu and Kashmir. They didn't. They responded with something else. After all, that is why you have strategic planning.
On the lighter notes, the age is catching up with Putin, that's why this is.
No, the problem was also that he's getting squeezed. See, the Soviet Union was a major power. They have sort of been declining economically and militarily over several years. They feel hemmed in from all sides. The same problem with our friends in Pakistan after they lost Bangladesh in 71. They feel aggrieved. Because the initial psychology, so I have my training officer was there in 1947. So he used to tell us, when the Navy was divided between Pakistan and India, several of his colleagues went to Pakistan. And they said, soon we will meet you in Delhi, saying that we will reinvade your country. And they invoke pictures of Ghazni, Ghori, and all characters who have occurred 1,000 years back. And they have this in their psychology. So when it was a huge shock to them when they lost Bangladesh, how could we get beaten? Right. No, they're not able to get over it. Right? It's a psychological hit. So you have to do something to hurt India, which is fine, which is their point of view. But the whole Kargil operation was misthought of. And it is not fully planned, because they didn't consider all options.
But NATO was made in such a point of view that they wanted to squeeze Russia and not to make them expand their borders.
What is India doing to Pakistan?
Huh?
What is India doing to Pakistan? You think they're very friendly and allowing them to flourish?
No. That is what I'm going to say. When Putin comes to know that this type of threats will come,
So that is why he's attacking. We are not talking about the rationale. You asked me whether Putin is a good leader. I said he is not because he did not consider all options. Yeah. So so one of my friends, close friends, is a Kuwaiti. I asked him, he says, I don't like Saudi Arabians. But we have to live with them because they're a huge country and we are a country that is the size of half the size of JP Nagar. Yeah, so we live with them. So these are, you don't have to like or dislike somebody, but you have to live with people. But if you're foolish enough to get into a war without understanding the end point, you will pay. So that's what happened to Hitler. That's what happened to Napoleon. That's what happened to Alexander. All of them overestimated their own intelligence and preparedness. Yeah. So they were poor leaders. Napoleon got bogged down in Russia. He miscalculated Mr. Winter. Hitler opened up too many fronts and lost. Eventually, Putin will, they will allow him to gracefully withdraw from Ukraine because he's getting squeezed economically. If you like Putin, just bad.
But
the fact of the matter is that the Americans have firmly got behind them. See, America, you hear all these cock and bull stories, they're declining, they're feeling, they're a third. They are an extremely rich country and they are 2.5 times the size of China, which if you have to believe, China's economy is close to about $10 trillion. They're 8 times the size of India. Yeah, they've got a landmass that, they've got the most agriculture in the world. They've got natural resources that no other country can match. They have got humongous resources. And if they have decided to bless you, then you stay blessed. So now India will also be blessed because they have decided that they have to make India a rich country. So you will see over the next 25 years, India will catch up with China. Why? Not because we are a good set of people. You know, if the United States takes their hand off countries like Japan, Korea, Taiwan, they will collapse. Yeah? The Americans decide from time to time which country they should make rich for what joy, not that they like you and your culture, because they want to do it. And that's how countries operate. If you are stupid enough to not look at your own self-interest, it is your fault. I like this fellow. He goes and buys Russian oil. Good. You're getting cheap oil. This is our interest. That is leadership. Situational leadership. Okay, guys, thank you very much. I see you in a couple of weeks' time.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.